Good evening, Perry.
I own a motel not too far from here, and you'd be welcome to spend the night in one of the empty rooms if you'd like.
Oh, it burns! Oh, it burns! And I'm the devil!
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Necronomicast. My name is Wayne.
This is Zip.
This is Brian.
It's Doug. Hey!
Hey. And it is a show about sharks.
Shark attack.
That's right. Yeah. Shark attack. In honor of what was Shark Week that everybody looks forward to. I look forward to it every year.
You know. Who doesn't?
You know.
I never know what's happening at all.
You never know what's happening.
No, but Brian told me to watch all the Jaws, so I did that. I wrote on the very week.
You had your
having
own,
no idea.
Your own private Shark Week.
I did.
Well, there it is.
I did.
It's July. A bunch of us were on vacations. You know, we haven't done a show in a couple weeks, and so here we are, summertime, the beaches are calling, and so we thought with the 40th anniversary of Jaws, we'd do a rundown of some great man-eating shark movies in cinema. So,
and Jaws.
And Jaws, one of the greatest films, my personal favorite movie of all time.
Really?
Is Jaws the first shark movie?
It was one of the first movies that they shot underwater.
Yes.
That was not underwater, but with a, you know, the concept of a one creature attacking with a, well, it kind of, yeah.
I mean, if you want to talk, if you want to go back to Old Man and the Sea, the Hemingway novel. With
that's not
Spencer
a movie.
Tracy. What the fuck? Is Spencer Tracy won an Oscar, did he? No, he won it for Boys Town.
I back off.
Back off, Doug.
You know, I'm
like
off.
Old Man in the Sea.
I am well.
It was an unprecedented way of filming, I guess, at the time. Okay. It was not really been done before.
Right.
Spielberg, that's why they thought there's no way we can do this movie.
Yeah, Spielberg invented or developed the whole putting the camera in. You know, like, so your eye view, the viewer's view is at the
bobbing
horizon.
In the water. Right.
Yes.
A box camera they
like
had.
Buoy
actually,
view.
Steven Spielberg didn't make that, but he...
I thought he did.
He didn't
no?
he come up with that. It was somebody else that was his production team. But, yeah, it was plagued with problems. So, let's talk first off. Okay, let's hit with Jaws.
Okay.
But it's your favorite movie of all time.
Of all time.
So, and we'll talk about kind of a little bit of a few things about why it was a classic, I think. But why was it your favorite?
It was, always will be, and is my favorite. I just think it's like the perfect movie for me. I love the adventure. It's swashbuckling toward the end, like when the three guys are on the boat.
Mm-hmm.
There's funny parts to it.
Yeah.
And it's scary as hell.
Oh,
I mean, we just watched it again. Zip comes over to my house now, a couple of years we've been doing this straight. I always watch Jaws around the 4th of July weekend because I just kind of throw myself...
Well, that's when it's set.
Exactly. That's why I do it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I remember reading the book as a kid. My parents, I've said this before on the show, my parents were older. My dad was 70 when I was born. My mom was in her 40s.
Ooh.
And so, yeah, okay. So,
no,
so
that's cool.
It is cool. But my point is, they, you know, they were very attentive to my needs, but they were old school. And as long as Brian was reading, everything must be fine. So I was reading like, you know, like I was a little kid. I was reading Jaws.
Yeah.
And we could talk about the differences between
fine.
The book and the movie.
Yeah.
I was reading The Exorcist and Cujo like when I was a kid. Like a kid. So I mean,
that explains
why,
everything.
Yeah, that's what, yeah. It explains a hell of a lot.
Yeah.
So Jaws, back to Jaws. It's funny as hell. There's some great, just funny scenes in it.
Mm-hmm.
The writing is top-notch. The direction, I can't believe Spielberg was in his 20s when he made it.
Right.
The music is iconic. I mean, even if, I don't know, you just do those, that EF. Mm-hmm. Everybody knows exactly, worldwide knows what the fuck that means.
Yeah.
Everybody. I can't think of a piece of music that's more iconic. And just the movie, to me, is just absolutely perfect. I just love everything about it. Mm. The acting, Quint's speech on about the Indianapolis.
Yes.
Amazing.
That's outstanding.
That whole scene, that is my favorite scene.
Yeah,
by far.
It's absolutely amazing. So, is it a horror film? I think, yeah. I think
it's a monster movie.
Yeah, it's a monster movie, but it's suspenseful. It's it's got, you know, it's just
it's a monster movie with limited monster for the most part, which
it's
is what is working nowadays.
Fish trying to get to eat.
He's just
come
hungry.
On, guys.
He's just hungry. It's an endangered species.
It's not a monster.
There's a few documentaries out there that you guys can check out too. We'll leave some links of it on the show page. It's really great. I'm going to go over some of the stuff that we're going to talk about today. But yeah, it was the lack of the reason why the shark didn't work. All that stuff turned out to make the movie really tense and a lot of anxiety just based off of the point of view of the shark.
Yeah.
So that's what scared me. I mean, all those gags worked on me at that age. And Jaws 2 was another one that I was terrified. I saw that in the theater and was terrified of.
Oh, you saw it in the theater. Wow. Okay.
Yeah. So the... scared living daylights out of me. But the, it's just, I'm thinking back going, oh my God.
Come back to us. Yeah. Come back.
I'm nervous. So the point of view thing, and I think people are starting to get back to that filmmaking-wise, and I think that's what, made it a pretty classic movie there, just because there wasn't shark in your face the entire time.
Yeah, you know, and that's, Spielberg probably wanted the shark in there more. But because of, you know, at one point I watched one of the documentaries, they said they even entertained the idea of seeing if they could train a shark to do something, jump when they wanted
to. Shark wrangler.
And they're like, no, we can't do that. So the whole production, you know, crew of making these sharks, and then, well, they worked fine in the test tank at Universal Studios. Then they get them down to Martha's Vineyard, and they put them in the ocean, and they start dissolving in the salt water, the
freaking
gears
out.
Rust up on them, you know, and they barely worked, and so they came up with this ingenious idea of using the barrels.
Yes.
Because it's just always lurking under the deep, and I thought that was just, you know, this one of those accidents, I guess.
And it's doing what it's doing with a barrel or several attached to it.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah, sure.
So you get a sense of power there without...
Yeah, there's a sense of power without, and also seeing where it is and what it's doing.
When Shaw's like,
you know,
Quint, Shaw... you can't go down there with three. Not with three, you can't. You know, and you're thinking, like, man, this giant shark is pulling these barrels.
Yeah.
It's great. And
you know, I saw that barrel you were talking about in part two that's outside of Brody's door. Yeah, when I watched it, I was like, oh, yeah, he stares at that because he came out of the truck drunk.
Yes.
You know, the cans fall on the ground.
When he gets fired.
And when he gets fired, and he just looks at it for a while.
There's a scene in Jaws 2 where when Brody gets fired for basically blowing up the city council. And he's kind of stumbling in his house, and he looks. The one of the barrels that him and Hooper kicked in on is a planter that his wife put flowers on outside their front door. And he kind of just looks at it for a second. And if you're not really thinking, you don't care.
I would have noticed it,
right?
But if you hadn't told me,
Well, let's see. Yeah. Jaws nut. I'm a Jaws nut.
Jaws nut.
So yeah, Jaws 2.
Jaws 2, I thought was almost as good as the first, but not quite as great. Like it still had Williams. Doing the score.
An original score, not just recycled like in the last two movies.
Yeah, the last two, they give him props for, like, we've borrowed the
Jaws theme.
But it was really good, but it didn't quite deliver the editing or whatever when the scares came. It didn't quite, maybe you saw too much shark. It wasn't nearly as bad as in the last two, but...
I watched
it. Didn't quite sell it to me on some of those parts, but the one that did though is when the girl and the guy are in the boat by themselves, and the shark comes, and I'm trying to remember how it was. Like the guy gets it, and then he's with it, and then he gets dragged all the way to the boat.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah. Like, and then crashes into the boat and grabs it, and she's like crying and stuff. That was pretty impressive.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't remember their names or anything like that. I was like, oh, this is actually working. Yeah,
right. They borrowed a lot, or they used a lot of the same kind of vibe from the first film. You know?
Yeah,
because that's how they did the original, the first kill in the very first film.
It was
with cables
that.
Tied to the act. She wasn't even an actress; she was an animal trainer that they used, and And so she can, you can get close-ups, and there doesn't have to be a stunt person. So they tied cables and drug her kind of back and forth and around, and then eventually down
that
underwater.
That first scene, yeah, that first scene is so good. And the thing that gets me every time when I see that first scene in Jaws is when she's dragged all around and stuff like that, and then she hits the buoy,
yeah,
and holds on to it, and is just so like, okay,
praying, she's
I'm
praying,
safe, yeah. And yeah, you know, and I'm like, oh my god. I guess because I've been there, like, you know, like after a bad night, and you're at the toilet, and you're like, oh god, okay,
hold on to the buoy,
it's all over,
it's all over,
we're good now, we're right, we're right, oh no, here we go again. Oh. So anyway, I can relate.
Oh god,
that was awesome, Doug.
Pulled under,
yeah,
pulled under, the-
yeah, totally,
yeah,
pulled older, pulled under by like a good old. Captain Jack or some yeah. shit, you know.
There's great continuity, I think, between one and two. You know, like in two, they really, you know, it was set in Amity, same principal actors, still had Murray Hamilton as the great the mayor. You know, Mrs. Brody. You know, there's great continuity. You know, so it.
And they even mentioned Hooper. Just a little
yeah,
bit.
Yeah, yeah, because like he couldn't.
He's on the other boat.
He's on the boat that he talks about in the first film.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right. It just didn't have the great source material of the first, because, you know, it was based on, the first movie was based on the book by Peter Benchley. You know, even though when Carl Gottlieb changed the screenplay around to make it, you know, a little bit easier to make a movie out of, you know, there's a lot of key differences between the book and the movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you were talking about that.
Yeah, there's a couple. Like in the book, Hooper and Mrs. Brody have an affair.
Boo.
Because she dated Hooper's older brother. In the book.
Even more weird.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
Boo, again.
Right. The whole thing about, there's more, it's kind of cooler in the book, the mayor, you know, like he's getting pressure from the people that own the hotels and the restaurants and everything to keep the beaches open. Well, in the book, it's the mafia.
That's oh, really?
Yeah, they're really heavily involved in the real estate of Amity Island, and they're like, you're not gonna close the beaches, mayor. You know, it's like, yeah, there's, yeah. You know, there's like a heavy hand that's not... As
oh, not really. Just the not just the business owners of the
right, it's the mafioso, right. It's the Cosa Nostra.
Well, speaking of the mayor, did you get the vibe of when I see it again after we were talking Poltergeist that the mayor is kind of the contractor
yeah.
Guy, same well, yeah, kind of antagonist. There's always one person. And, no, don't worry about that.
It's the same thing. There's the evil money grubbing
yeah.
Bad guy.
The suit.
That's like money over humanity. Yeah. You know, forget, fuck those people getting eaten by sharks. We got money to make here.
Yeah, you know.
Fuck those dead bodies. We'll just we'll just build houses over the top of them.
Right. And then even Murray Hamilton, like he's like when they're in the hospital after the guy gets eaten in the estuary, he's even kind of smoking a cigarette in the hospital.
Right. Yeah.
But he's like,
it was a different time.
I didn't know. We can still save August, you know, or whatever he's saying. It's just like, you know, it's just great. I think he was just a fantastic actor, and he plays the heavy hand, but he's also like almost having a psychotic episode.
That'd be a good band name, Still Save August.
Doesn't sound like that. Yeah, see? Still, totally.
There you go.
You can have an accordion in it, and maybe a some sort of mandolin.
I don't know, that could be like a post-metal, contemporary metal band.
Still Save August.
When towers fall, opening for Still Save August.
Yeah, I don't think I could be in that one though.
Mm-mm.
So yeah, so there's Jaws 1 and 2.
Yeah,
that, right. The scene with the ski when he turned over the ski.
Oh yeah.
So talk about effects and whatnot like that. I thought that was really effective to me, that gag when he turns over the ski and it came. I remember being in the
back of
the
theater. He sees that piece
of
wood floating, and it's almost, was it a ski or a piece of the boat that blew?
Oh, maybe it was a piece.
I think
of the
boat. It was a piece of the
fried
boat.
To.
Yeah, she's like burned to it. Yeah.
Oh. I always thought it was one of the skis. But then when I watched it again when I was older, I didn't, because I think it scared the shit out of me. Because when it came lunging at her, that was one of my first, you know, because I was young at that point, and I hadn't seen a whole lot of horror films in the theater. And that just was like, oh, no, we're out of here.
Yeah.
I almost left.
There's a great scene when the shark eats one of the teens toward the end, and the shark kind of lunges out of the water and gets him from behind. Mm-hmm. Or a girl from behind, and you hear the crunch. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a whatever.
Oh, wow. Impressive effects.
Thanks. When he's chewing on her, and I was just watching it before I let you borrow it, and just hearing that through the surround sounds was like, oh god. It's ghastly. Yeah, the whole thing with the helicopter, I don't know about that, but... You know.
It's not Lake Placid or anything.
Huh? Right, yeah, we're not talking Lake Placid. Yeah. So that's a pretty effective film, and it was a hit for Universal.
Was it?
Yeah.
So it did pretty well?
It did great.
Yeah. And there's all sorts of stuff out there you can...
The indie was awesome with the shark.
Oh, yeah.
Electrified. That was pretty cool.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's like, oh, Bob, say, ah! Oh! I don't know if he said motherfucker.
I don't think he said motherfucker.
No, I don't know. I would have said that.
Say, ah!
Say, ah!
You got to have a tagline before you blow it up, you know? Smile, you
this wasn't
bitch.
Quite Die Hard Times yet, so.
No, not really.
Yeah, it was more like, he did say son of a bitch in the first one, right?
Yeah, he did say son of a bitch. Yes, yeah. So then there was like a 5-year break between 2 and 3. Have you guys seen 3? I know I brought
you 3. I remember that. The Westroads in 3D.
I saw it at the Westroads.
I saw it in 3D, but I don't remember a damn thing about it.
Remember it much like it was.
Other than it was in 3D.
All underwater, the underwater, you know, place.
Calvin Bouchard. That's the Louis Gossett Jr. character. He's like the mayor. No, because he's like the CEO of SeaWorld.
Pretty much.
Isn't it weird that they had it at SeaWorld?
Yeah, I thought so too. And so did Trillity when she was watching with me. She watched the second half with me. And we were like, wow, this must be like, at the time they thought this was all, you know, like positive. Getting a shark in captivity is kind of like back in the 60s when Monsanto was doing all this great shit.
Yeah, you bet.
You know?
Better living through chemistry.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Right.
That's what this is, you know?
Yeah, it's funny that SeaWorld, as you look back on a 1983 film, that SeaWorld lent their likeness and trademark and name.
Yeah,
they didn't even. I mean, California.
And Shamu was mentioned by name and probably seen in it.
Yeah.
I think she's riding a Shamu around the
She feeds it at some point when they're talking. Yeah. But, SeaWorld. I mean, like Disneyland, there was in California, by Disneyland, there was a marine park called Marineland.
Oh, yeah.
So they didn't even give it a. Kind of a funny name like Sea Land or something. It's Sea World.
They did a thing together,
a cooperative crossover.
Exactly.
The ultimate product placement,
cross merchandising. There,
yeah, but I don't know.
I was surprised too by that.
That movie's a little weird, though. I mean, I really wanted to get into it, like watching it again. Universal just came out with a 3-pack of the sequels, 2, 3, and 4. So I watched 2 and I got into it. I'm like, yeah, I remember 2. I haven't watched in a while, because I watch Jaws every year.
Yes.
Jaws 3? Oh, man. I don't know.
I mean, they get progressively worse.
Well, of course.
Like everything.
Like
no, sometimes they go up and down. You know, like maybe like Halloween movies or something.
Or
like
Star
that.
Trek movies.
Yeah, you're right.
I know you're a huge Trek
fan. This one's a typical doorstop. Yeah, yeah.
Two, three, four. Yeah.
You know. But the 3D things were fun. And the end where the shark blows up, and then the jaws come flying at you.
Oh, yeah, 3D effects.
That's pretty cool, you know?
The 3D effects, yeah.
Oh, and Leah Thompson's first film.
Leah Thompson, yes.
I believe.
Absolutely. And I thought Bess Armstrong was cute when I was a kid.
Oh, she was so cute. Yeah, I was like, whoa. I don't know who you are, but you're pretty cute. Yeah.
And Louis Gossett Jr., you know, I thought he was great. Now, our guest on the last show that we did on the Hannibal Lecter, our friend Paul. Paul and I used to quote... Louis Gossett Jr. in Jaws 3 all the time because he just had these great lines. When the shark rams the underwater tank and everybody's freaking out and he like has the microphone on, hello out there, this is Calvin Bouchard. We've had a slight problem with the piping system. He's all nice and smooth and then he's like, is this microphone off? Yeah. Give me some lights down there. There's shit down there. Need medical attention quick. You know, we used to talk that shit all the time. Hello out there. This is Calvin Bouchard. But Louis Gossett Jr. is great, man. Iron Eagle, all that shit. But he's just, but he's the heel in the movie because he's like, he sees the dollar signs of putting the little baby great white shark. And baby great white born in the park. You know, that's still fuzzy with me. You know?
But at the time, they don't even realize it's a baby.
You're talking about a damn shark's mother?
But that was the cool part, that the reveal kind of was like, wait, this is just a baby. The mother.
Yeah. Oh, the mother.
The mother killed so-and-so in the park.
blah, 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 in the park. The mother's
in the mother park.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and it's like, I remember as a kid going, oh, damn, it got real. It got real. The mother's in the park.
Damn, Shock's mother.
Yeah.
Because I was because when I was watching, I was like, this, and me and Trilly were like, this is a little damn shark. This is pretty sad.
Right.
You know, kind of until we got to that part, and then and then it got really big, you know.
So. The giant shark, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. The shark didn't roar in part three like it did in part four.
Because sharks roar.
Well, part four, jeez, that whole thing roared like a big vomiting.
And what's funny, and I trace my history of watching film, in the summer of 87, I went with my family to Hollywood, Disneyland, Los Angeles. We went to Universal Studios, and I actually saw Jaws the Revenge opening weekend at the movie theater at Universal Studios.
Really?
And man...
Did you go to the Jaws
My
ride?
Toes were hard that day. Yeah. Yeah, of course. Of course. Yeah, you ride the bus to Universal Studios, and the guy, the tour bus guy was saying, as you know, he's talking about the sights and everything, and now when we get to Universal Studios, you'll want to sit on the right side of the tram because you'll see, you know what I mean? And so I'm like totally so excited to see this. And when I was a kid, I saw the movie and I thought, wow, this is, you know, new Jaws movie, and I really liked it. Mm-hmm. In 1987. Then watching it now, and I know I'm just so much more sophisticated as I watch
your palette has changed.
That's right. Yeah, it's much more sophisticated.
You don't like the Bahamas?
That's how I feel when I watch Kiss Meets the Phantom of the Park.
Yeah, right.
It was the greatest
this
fucking
was
movie
the greatest
ever.
Movie when I was 8. Now it's stupid.
God, it's just inept, horrible filmmaking.
Oh my God.
You know, horrible. I don't think it's as bad as you think.
We should do a
because
show
because you
that.
Love the first one so much. That's how Trilly and I, when we were watching,
yeah,
we
I
thought.
Know. Yeah.
Trilly is my best friend, by the way. I don't know if everyone out there knows that. But anyway, we were watching.
We should do a dark side of the movie of that one.
Oh.
Jaws of Revenge?
That would be way better than freaking Zombie Road.
I don't know.
I got to tell you. Yeah. But it wasn't that. It sucked.
Oh,
but it was not totally inept.
Yeah.
You're looking at me every wrinkle you could possibly have on your
forehead. I know, I'm wrinkling my forehead over here.
That's a stare down.
I'm like, serious, man, it wasn't that bad.
Brian is throwing shade in this episode a lot right now.
Well, compared to the first one, you're right.
Right.
But compared to other movies that are out there, no, it was all right. And it had, that doesn't save it, but it has the lead guy is from...
Lance Guest.
Yeah.
Yeah, Last Starfighter.
Last Starfighter. So that's got to be worth something, right?
And he has sex with Karen Allen a lot, so I guess that's cool.
Yeah, I thought that was cool.
Well, who doesn't?
No. It wasn't that bad, though.
Oh, God damn, man. That movie's...
Michael Caine. Hoagie. Yeah. Hoagie.
Michael Caine.
Yeah, see?
Jumps into the water, swims away from the shark... And his shirt is dry when he jumps up on the boat, and the Neptune's falling.
It's made of chamois.
He's sham wow shirt.
It's a shirt wow.
Back to the Future shirts that self drying shirts. You know?
Yeah, that was it. So I mean, I look back and I was at Universal Studios and I saw they actually dug a fake lake or an ocean kind of scene with a painted background, and you can kind of tell. Wait. You can see the water splash up in that movie up against the painted back.
I do think you're right. Cause
I am
think
right.
There were, well, yeah, I know this. But I agree. You're right, because there were some scenes like that. I'm like, that really looks like they're in a tank.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe not for the reason that I saw it splash, but I'm like, yeah, that really looks like a tank.
You can see the thing moving on the gear on the fin.
It says 8 feet, you know.
No diving.
No diving.
And they show the shark way too much in that one, more than ever before.
Oh, yeah. They're making up for lost time.
Yeah. And the ending sucks. You're confused. You said there was a cut that I didn't see?
Yeah, the original theatrical ending is Mrs. Brody. You know, the shark just eats Mario Van Peebles' character, Jake.
Yes.
Just eats him. After they throw that stupid thing into his stomach to shock the hell out of him and confuse it, Mon.
Oh, yeah.
So
we never understood it, that Mon.
Right, man. Because he's
zap it, zap it.
No, nothing's happening. So then she's having flashbacks to things that she has no comprehension of seeing. She didn't see Martin Brody.
That's a good point.
Shooting. You know, she's having
yeah,
these.
She's not out there.
Flashbacks of things she couldn't see.
Maybe she's an angel now. That's funny. Yeah. Near death experience. Yeah, and she's right? out over the orca.
So then her son is shocking the fish with this thing. The shark jumps out of the water, and the stern of the boat rams the shark, stabs him, which is. Actually, not that bad of effect. I mean, in all honesty, it's kind of
stabbing
cool.
is always a win.
And then the weight of the shark cracks the boat in half, and then it sinks, and you see the shark with the stern of the boat penetrating it.
Okay.
And earlier, you hear the shark's heartbeat, you know, because they put the sensor in it. Uh-huh. So you hear it go gung 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 gung. Shark's yeah. dead. Okay. Now, in the home video and international release, Jake lives, huh? And then she rams the shark with the boat, same as before. It pierces him, and then the shark blows up.
That's what I thought.
What the fuck was that all about? Oh, and then if you freeze frame it, and if
it's
you go...
It's a serious piercing, man.
Stop listening to the podcast now. Go and open up another window. Get the Wikipedia page on Jaws 4 and look at... There's a picture on the Wikipedia page for Jaws 4 of the shit-ass... special effects that they did with that shark. It looks like it's made with modeling clay. It's awful.
It's claymation.
Like, why would the shark blow up? Oh my god. I mean, and then they all get on the boat and they're like, oh, take care of Jake. All right, Alan, I'm gonna fly you to, let me tell you the story. And then if, you know, like, whatever.
Yeah, I know. In the end, I was like, is that the real ending? Because it seemed kind of fake.
I'm glad I bought the three movies for $7.99.
Seemed like a fake out, yeah.
Because I know I'll watch Jaws 2 again. I will watch Jaws 3 again some point in my life before I pass away. Jaws 4?
No,
I don't know.
You're going to watch it a lot more because if we do a dark side of the movie on it, you're going to
do that.
Make me a couple cookies and I will.
Yeah, there we go. And we will.
We'll all do it in this voice, man.
That's right.
I'm terrible at this voice. Right. I don't sound Jamaican at all.
Take a
I sound like a leprechaun.
He's a Jamaican. Irish.
Man. Give me your lucky charms, man. So, yeah.
But I love sharks, man. I love. My daughter and I just watched some shark week stuff that we had recorded tonight. I mean, I went to Florida when I was a kid, and I don't know if they still do this, but I bought a fetal shark in a jar, and you've seen it. It's in my music studio. Okay. Love sharks. So, you know, the Jaws movies, 1 and 2, 1, are pretty special to me, so...
What other... you brought a list of some other potential shark movies. Of course, now we've got CGI, so we can have all the sharks that we want. Sharknado, yeah. Sharknado 2, 3, the Sharknados.
I have not seen any of those.
I've not seen any of those.
I've not watched them all the way through.
Zip and I watched, Deep Blue Sea from 1999, which is a pretty... I like Deep Blue Sea.
I like it. It was kind of corny at the end, but
you bet.
It's all right.
Have you guys seen Deep Blue Sea?
No, like I was saying, I thought maybe it was a sci-fi thing because I thought I saw something like that on their site.
No, it was a theatrical release, and it actually made some pretty good money. They made it for about $60 million, and it made over $165 million worldwide. It was a modest hit for Rennie Harlan, who made like Cliffhanger and Nightmare on Elm Street 3 or 4. I think it's 4 because Wes Craven made 3, right? Or no, he wrote it. I don't know. But Rennie Harlan, married to Gina Davis, did Deep Blue Sea. Has LL Cool J. The whole thing is...
Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
Yeah, the whole thing is they have this Aquatica...
Smart sharks.
...laboratory where they're researching Alzheimer's and how to defeat it.
There's some sort of enzyme...
Right, that they extract from a genetically modified short fin mako shark.
Right, where they violate the Harvard Agreement or whatever it is it had to do with the enhancing, genetically modifying the sharks.
Right.
It was a violation. You know, what's funny about that is, at the end of the movie, LL Cool J makes a comment about the brother always dies in the movie. And then, at the end of it, I was like, well, maybe, because it looked like he was gonna.
Yeah.
You know, but then he doesn't. But then I was like, well, the chick, you know, the chick's gotta live. It's gotta be two people, right?
The hot chick?
I thought the scientist chick, but then I remembered she's the evil one. She's the one that was doing the genetic modifications. Of course she has.
Well, but you have to feel sorry for a little bit because grandma had Alzheimer's, wasn't
it? Well, everybody's grandmas have Alzheimer's. Not to be a dick.
But. No, my grandma was.
Well, I'll be one right here.
But it was her It was her fault.
Yeah, so she's the one that they're all at the thing like, this is all your fault. If you hadn't modified them sharks
genetically,
in that hurricane.
Yeah, then the hurricane didn't help matters any.
Right. But just got such a kick out of it because it's like, it's Jaws, but it's Jaws lurking around your apartment building.
Yes.
Down the hallway, through door opening doors.
Yes.
Flooding the elevator shaft and coming up the elevator shaft.
Swimming in your classroom.
Yeah, exactly. Swimming in your lab.
Yeah, and the sharks are pretty, I thought they were pretty good.
Yeah,
like,
they were
good. Believable. You know, it was early
and
onset.
It was a 3D movie, too. Forgot about that. But then when you're watching it, you're like, there's so much in your face. Or when the shark bites the guy in half and his leg is like, his lower.
Twitching.
His foot is like twitching and it's like in space right in front of you. It's like, oh, that would have been awesome in 3D.
Yeah.
See that guy's twitch?
Right. Yeah, and there's the sharks are good in that movie. There's also a nice wink to Jaws fans in there when they catch the tiger shark.
Oh, yeah.
To feed to the genetically modified sharks, he's got a license plate stuck in his jaw. And Thomas Jane pulls it out and throws it down, and it's the same license plate
that they pull out of the tiger shark
in Jaws. Right. And then there's three modified sharks in Deep Blue Sea. The first one, LL Cool J, blows up.
Yeah,
like Jaws 1 blows up. The second shark is electrocuted by the doctor.
Yeah.
And then the third
lab, somehow she gets out of the electrocuted water.
Well, she put her wetsuit down to act as insulation because she had to be insulated from the water and also show her in a bra and panties.
Right.
Yeah.
They had to do that.
Of course.
Huh. And so then the third shark is blown up at the end. So in the shark in three, Jaws 3 is blown up. So I think there's kind of a wink.
Early, one thing I forgot about it until I watched the movie again was the trying to life flight the guy on the cable up the helicopter.
Yes.
And it ends up getting jammed and then descending in there. And then the shark grabs the guy in the strapped to the stretcher and is dragging the helicopter down.
Oh my God. I have
to the ground.
As a kid, I was terrified of that knife. What do they call that thing? Life flight? Does the idea of hanging from a helicopter in a bed by yourself, you know, I don't know if that's
spinning around in midair.
Really how it is.
And being
is.
Trapped.
Yeah. Oh, it scared me. So I'm glad I've never seen that.
Innate
fear.
I think that movie's pretty good.
I mean, more fear.
I think that
movie's
pretty good.
And my favorite scene in it, of course, is Samuel L. Jackson is in the middle of giving a very motivating speech.
Like he does. It's almost it's almost like a farce on.
And it's right at the point when he says, like, we're going to swim our way out of here. And all of a sudden, the shark jumps out of the water and snatches him mid-sentence.
Yeah, that's the best. I remember, I think I squirted a little my pants when that happened the first time I saw that in the theater back in 99.
Because it's a big surprise.
Yeah, and he's like, we will get out. You know, he's like doing his best preacher imitation. Yeah. We will live. We will survive. And chomps him up, too. It's great.
Yeah.
They didn't roar, did they? Did they roar?
No, it was like, just everybody in the theater.
They were Jaws 4 sharks.
Everybody in the theater screamed. That was great.
Yeah.
Another good one. Has anybody seen Open Water?
I'm still afraid to. I did not.
It's streaming on Netflix right now.
I'm scared to see it. Sorry.
You host a horror show. You have homework.
What? I'm scared.
We'll watch it together.
Can we hold hands?
Yeah.
Open Water's great. Came out in 2001. And it's like one of those films that only has 2 stars. It's got Blanchard Ryan, who is smoking hot in it.
Okay, you're talking me into it. Keep going.
And there's frontal nudity in the movie.
Frontal nudity. Oh, well, jeez.
Tell me more, Brian.
See what you're missing out on, Doug?
I know already.
You can't see that kind of stuff anywhere else.
No.
That's true.
Horror movies.
Yeah, just right.
Yeah, maybe I can find it elsewhere.
Regardless, she's great in the movie. I mean, like, acting-wise. So her and her husband, Daniel. Excuse me, I had piranhas for lunch.
Piranhas?
We've noticed.
They have this really jet-set, busy lifestyle, so they decided to get away for a while, and they go snorkeling. And I forget where they say they go. So they go snorkeling. Long story short, they go out on this excursion where you pay. The boat takes you out, drops you off in a location, like 20 people. Mm-hmm. And then so the guy miscounted. Because Daniel thinks he's hot shit. He thinks he's the best diver in the world. So he's kind of diving around. They miss the boat. So then they're stuck in open water. for like 2 days, and then all
they do that like kind of Home Alone miscount thing, right?
Well, yeah, like one, some reason it was kind of confusing. One guy, he didn't bring, what did he forget? He forgot like a mask or fins, and then one lady, she got water in her nose or something, so he borrowed her mask, and then he went down, but he wasn't down during the original count, and then, you know, it was just one of those things.
One of those, yeah, those switch up things that they...
So they find out the next morning, the guy's like getting his boat ready for the excursion the next day, and he sees, oh, hello, there's her purse and her, you know, whatever, so he freaks out, they get the choppers out there and everything. Long story short, they get eaten by the sharks at the end. So
you spoiled the whole movie right there.
Huh? Well, I mean, there's no happy ending to this one.
But we were talking earlier, you didn't do that.
They used real sharks in this movie. I don't know how they filmed it, but what's neat about it, they used handheld digital cameras, so it's got kind of a grainy, not found footage because it's totally scripted, and it looks a little cheap.
Yeah, but you're talking about the look of it, so that would be found footage, right?
Right. It's not shaky cam, but you could tell it's not... Okay. Panavision high
not
dollar
steady
cameras.
Cam.
You know what I'm talking about.
Is it swimmy cam? Is it swimmy cam?
Yeah. Yeah, but just
this guy goes up and down, up and down.
Yeah,
up and down.
And personally, I'll tell you a quick personal story. And
can't wait.
It came out and sit back. So in 2001, my wife and I got married, and we went on a honeymoon to Hawaii. Right, 2001. This movie came out after our honeymoon. But so we went to Hawaii, and we did one of these excursions. The same damn thing. So they drop you off in three spots. Right, they drop you off over here in this really shallow kind of place. We're passing something around here. So they drop you off in one spot. You go snorkeling, beautiful coral, beautiful fish. Then they pick you up and they take you to spot number two. Beautiful coral, beautiful fish. Then they were going to take us to spot number three to end the day before you have your little box lunch on the boat.
Beautiful
and they
coral,
said,
beautiful fish.
They said, well, you know, the water's really choppy over on this part of the island, so we're going to take you to our alternate place where the water's not choppy, but the water was very, very murky. So we get into the water, all of us 20 people. Heather and I are looking around.
Murky water, murky fish.
Tiger sharks is what I... Because I've been watching Shark Week for 20 years. You know, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah, you know.
I'm the kid that has the shark in his room, you know, like the jar of a shark, you know. And so I kind of said to my wife, boy, I'm not seeing very much. And she's like, yeah, me either. And I'm like, you know, tiger sharks love murky water. Bam, we are out of the boat. I'm just like, we got to go to the river.
Yeah.
So then that fall, open water comes out, and Heather and I were just like, we are lucky we didn't end up as chum. You know, so yeah, open water, made for $130,000 by the filmmakers, and then they sold the rights to whoever released it for $2.5 million, and it went on to gross $55 million. So it's a super profitable hit film.
I want to see it.
My favorite one that I've seen recently is Shark Night.
It's about a shark that is in the Middle Ages.
Yes, sir.
And he's like Batman, only a shark.
Sir,
or like
the Shark Knight.
A shark that's
a Shark Knight, and it's basically Friday the 13th with sharks.
Yeah.
No.
It takes place on a lake. It's a saltwater lake in Louisiana.
Really?
Where Tucker and Dale, I'm sorry, they're called Dennis and Red, but it's Tucker and Dale.
And
the local sheriff, played by Donald Logue. Who I remember from Dow of Steve, and also
I love that guy.
He was the greasy dude on MTV in the early
the taxi
90s.
Driver, right?
Taxi driver guy.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, Donald
he was
Logue.
In sneakers.
He's the sheriff. But basically, it's like kids, you know, kids that go to college students, you know, just like Friday the 13th Part 3 begins, and Cabin in the Woods begins.
Yeah,
college students in their dorms get together. They're going to go on this trip. They drive to the trip.
Exactly.
They get there and everybody starts dying.
As it
because
should
they're
be.
Because
these,
swimming.
These hillbillies have been these Cajun guys have been pulling sharks out of the ocean and putting them in this saltwater lake to feed college students to them.
Well, because they want to film them.
Well, they want to film them for it's sort of like a combination of Shark Week
and Girls Gone Wild
and, Shark Week
and Snow Film. Face of Death.
Face of Death, right.
What's that called again?
Shark Night.
Shark Night?
I'm Shark Night.
And it was directed by the guy that made David Ellis, and he made Final Destination and the Final Destination.
Yeah.
So he...
It was interesting. I learned about a new shark. from that. Right. It's called the Cookie Cutter Shark.
Okay.
And they're kind of small, and they kind of travel in schools a little bit. Mm-hmm. What they do is they basically, in the movie, I don't know if this is really how it works in real life, that they take a little bite of you, and then they spin and rip a cookie cutter-sized chunk of flesh out of you.
Okay.
And so they drop her into a net full of them, and so it's almost like she's getting eaten by piranhas.
And it's Catherine McPhee.
Yeah, and they bite her. They would take a bite, and then it spins in midair and rips that chunk of flesh off you.
Yeah,
yeah, it's pretty insane.
That. Yeah,
like an orb from Phantasm or something.
But it's PG-13, so if it was R, it would have been there's a lot of people getting pulled underwater and eaten that way.
Yeah,
not like the visceral people getting ripped apart like in Deep Blue Sea or anything like that. But yeah, it's not bad. I mean, you're totally right. It is. Camp Crystal Lake with sharks.
Exactly. That's exactly what it is. It was fun. It was fun.
It's a fun, dumb movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What about Sharknados?
I saw the original.
I don't know anything about them.
Right.
Don't know.
One and two are streaming on Netflix right now. I saw the first one.
I don't want
one.
To.
Oh, yeah. But they're, I mean, they're...
Are you afraid?
I'm afraid of wasting my time.
Right. And that's a
good answer.
Big issue.
I don't think so. I think if you... have the right night, the right.
That's true. That's true. It might be. Yeah, that might be something that.
Right supplies, you'll be fine. Yeah.
Right, you need supplies to watch
and
that
and
film.
And friends, I think it would be a good time.
Yeah,
a little preparation with the supplies.
In fact, I'm going to invite all of you guys and my friends over to watch the Lavalantula on the 25th. Yeah. If you're free, I haven't done an invite yet, but yeah.
And our worldwide audience
over on Manawa, so we can go swimming and stuff during the afternoon.
Is that an avalanche of lava spiders?
No, it is. It's giant spiders that have lava as their inside them, their blood, and they spew fire,
like their venom.
Yeah, exactly.
Sweet.
Like Lavalantula.
Lavalantula.
Yeah, it's the latest sci-fi thing. So
they've got lots of them.
So Sharknado is on Netflix. Sharknado 2, which I haven't seen, which takes place in New York. Sharknado, the original, was in Los Angeles. And then they're later this summer, Sharknado 3, and the tagline is, oh, hell no.
Yeah.
That's what it is. Sharknado 3, no.
Oh, hell no, not again.
Yeah. They're fun. They're just,
they're not serious.
You cannot apply any kind of...
Well, on the sci-fi ones, they've had a few of the shark ones. It was Sand Sharks. Remember Sand Sharks?
Yeah.
With Hulk Hogan. Cindy... what's her name?
Brooke.
Brooke Hogan starred in that one. Was it Sand Sharks? I thought it was Sand Sharks. Where they actually swim in the sand.
Yeah.
Oh, well,
They're very dangerous. Very dangerous.
Ghost Shark? Did you see Ghost Shark?
Oh, God, Ghost Shark. Oh, my God, I forgot about that.
Any place water appears?
Any place. Like a kid's on a... spit on the ground and a shark could.
The ghost of the shark, right?
They had a dog pee in a puddle and it came out of the puddle and ate
really?
The dog.
Kid on one of those wet bananas. What are they called? You know, the slip and slide? Yeah.
Or the wet
banana. He's on one of those and the shark comes out of the slip and slide.
Yeah.
That's terrifying because the kid's not ready for that.
Well,
you know?
I remember having swimming lessons when I was a kid and I think there's even a Facebook meme.
On a slip
meme.
And slide?
No. But I think there's even a Facebook meme about childhood fears, and there's a swimming pool with a shark in it.
Oh,
like, sitting out there.
Yeah.
Of course.
I was a little nervous about being
that's why you stay on the slip and slide.
Well, not in
that case, ghost sharks.
Not in ghost shark.
But of course, if we went to investigate it,
nothing would be
there'd be no ghost shark. We would kill
it. Stick out of the stupid thing.
Right.
Maybe so people know what the hell you're talking about, you should plug our future episode or something.
Oh, we'll do that at the end of the show.
Well, then maybe sound stupid for
bringing it up. That's good though, but we want people to listen all the way to the end so they can win the new car.
That's right.
Oh yeah, the car.
The keys are under your seat right now.
Look under your seat.
Well, let's take a break.
If it's not there, you didn't win.
Mm.
Let's take a break. That's our shark episode
for the
month. Yeah. That is a terrible sound effect.
Fuck this show.
You guys make fun of me too much.
Oh, we do not. We love Doug, and everybody. I think you're our favorite host that the audience loves, right? If you love Doug, let us know.
You're the audience favorite.
Okay, yeah, we're going to take a break.
Haven't got an email yet.
When we come back, we have our segments coming up. We have some new Scream in the Darks.
Yep.
And maybe even a new not Scream in the Dark, but
New Screams.
New Screams.
New Screams.
After this.
Hey guys, it's Kendall, the unpaid intern of the shows. Right now, the hosts are at Jerry's Bar at 6301 Military, right here in the Benson neighborhood in Omaha, Nebraska. Rob, the owner, apparently has amazing drink specials, 19 beers on tap, premium spirits, and a cozy neighborhood atmosphere. Everybody is welcomed, except for me, because I can't drink. I have to sit home watching our cats. Thanks, Rob. Thanks. 68104 ever.
So you like to watch scary movies on Hulu or Netflix? Well, now it's time for Stream in the Dark.
And we're back with Stream in the Dark. So, we've got a few things. There's a couple of movies. I saw one movie, and it's not necessarily a horror movie. It's on Netflix. You can stream. I started to watch Monsters, Dark Continent, and I realized that this was a sequel to Monsters. It's one of the movies that on there that I kept looking at, and I didn't know if it was like a kid movie or anything like that, but I just kept passing it up. So finally read about this, that it was that Dark Continent is the sequel 6 months after the events of Monsters. So I went back and watched Monster. I read a lot of the reviews on this movie, and it's funny because this seemed like one of the movies that people, you either just think it's, you don't get it, or there's hardcore lovers of this movie. This is a great film. It was a low-budget movie. Still low-budget. It had 7 crew members and 2 actors, and they were basically doing what they call opportunistic filmmaking. So they were in Mexico. So everything you see in the movie is exactly that. There's no sets. There's no necessarily other extras or actors, because everybody you see in the movie as an extra basically was there at the time. They're just real people. They happened to be there. They were incorporated in the movie. A number of different things like that that they did this movie for. The director and the writer, he basically got a computer and got a movie editing software from the store and did the effects on this. So this movie is great because it is... it's almost like the Cloverfield thing. Giant monsters have invaded, basically, and they're supposedly benign, but they are just so big that, of course, the humans now are scampering around like ants, shooting them, and of course they're retaliating. But you don't really see them. It's not really about the monsters at all. It is about this couple that is trying to get across the border back into America, and to do that, they have to go through a lot of different things. And the subplot is all about the monsters and all them getting closer and closer to the infected zone, and then you do get to see some of the monsters, and the effects are pretty decent. They were not, you know, some of them I was wondering, wow, that's, you can do, how did he do that with that kind of software? But what I read in some of the reviews, the guy said that it was basically he could get technology that was the same as they did in Jurassic Park back in the 90s. So So, and these were, and you can tell, it was in the, you know, the main giant monster scenes that you see are kind of dark, and it's, so there's a lot that you have to put together in your head, which I really enjoyed too. Mm-hmm. And it's about the survivors, about these people trying to go there. So see it, Monsters, I'm giving it a thumbs up, it's recommended. It's on Netflix now, and as is Dark Continent, which I'm going to watch next. But that was my Stream of the Dark. Brian, you have something.
Yeah, I got back from vacation yesterday afternoon, and I thought, well, let's watch something. And I came across a movie that just came out on Netflix 2 days ago as we taped this. It was released on Netflix as the platform. And it's called Creep. And it's a 2014 found footage horror comedy film. Now, don't go running and screaming, you know, because it's somewhat found footage. It's actually really effective and pretty funny, and it's creepy as hell. It's directed by a guy named Patrick Bryce. He's one of the stars. There's only 2 guys in it, this guy Patrick Bryce. And he and Mark Duplass wrote it. Mark is the guy that played the main scientist in Lazarus Effect. Mm. That was married to Olivia Wilde in that movie. So these guys are 2 buddies, and so they decided to make a film together. And what it is Mark Duplass's character's name's Joseph, and he puts out a Craigslist ad saying, I need you to film me for a day. And what's revealed is that he says his character has, you know, inoperable cancer, and he's going to die within a certain number of months, and he wants to make this kind of video diary for his unborn child. His wife's sick, like 6 months pregnant or something like that. So this guy decides, yeah, you know, I'll take the $1,000 and film me for the day doing all these kind of things. So there's some tension that builds and whatnot, and it's kind of funny because this, the guy's character is really off the wall, and then it gets progressively creepier. A kind of a satisfying ending too, but I would really recommend Creep because you know, it doesn't take itself too seriously. I mean, if you're looking for, if you're one of these horror guys that listens to our show and you want something hardcore, you're going to think that the wheels are spinning on this thing a little bit, but but for what it is, I wanted a kind of a quick hour and 17 minute horror film. It's effective, it's kind of funny, and they say, you know, these guys' careers are taking off, so they say that they're going to make two more. There's going to be a Creep trilogy, and I don't know how they're going to do it. But, you know, for an hour and 17 minutes out of your life, I would recommend it. It's one of those found footage films.
So are they going to continue to be released on Netflix?
Yeah, they're still working on number two because they're, you know, they're busy with, like, bigger, big-time movies because these guys are like buddies, you know.
Right.
You all right?
Oh, sorry.
Chuck's taking a personal call.
Wait, can you hear that? Wait.
What are you looking
at?
You
have it wrong.
Mark Duplass.
Duplass? What did I say?
Duplass.
Yeah.
So anyway.
Tomato, tomato. Haley's Comet. Hallie's Comet.
No.
But it's good. Go watch Creep. Watch Creep.
Mark Duplass.
For Christ's sake.
Mark Duplass.
8% Doug, ladies and gentlemen.
8% Doug.
Watch Creep. I'm out of here.
All right.
I'm just trying to be the fact checker.
I'm going to drop the mic on this thing.
Let's go to New Screams. Or no, wait. Yeah, New Screams. New Screams.
You guys can't even talk. Don't blame me.
And now it's time for New Screams. That was a scream? Sounds like a goat to me.
All right. New Scream. So the gallows. We had talked about this earlier on another episode about going to see. We haven't gone as a
no.
As we're taping this, we have
I'm
not.
Curious. What have you heard?
I've heard that, well, it's not getting great reviews. Not getting great reviews.
It's getting great press.
Yes.
Interestingly enough.
And it made a boatload of cash for what it cost to make.
Guy was on coast. Well, not just the one guy. A couple guys are on coast. I mean, it was in the middle of the night, but that's a big, you know, radio.
It's
program.
Pronounced co-ast.
Now you're just being a jerk. I'd fight you, but you'd beat my ass.
Yeah.
So yeah, it takes place. We taped this in Nebraska, in Omaha, Nebraska. The show and the movie takes place in Beatrice
not
High School, which is not Beatrice.
Yeah,
yeah, right.
Which is down the road from Omaha. So we've got kind of a hometown or a local kind of flavor to it. So we're excited to see it.
Was
at least.
It filmed there? Do we know?
They filmed some parts there, but they didn't make the final theatrical cut, according to the article I read in the paper.
Yeah, I think most of it was.
So it's all a lie. California. It's all a big lie.
They will make the DVD or the Blu-ray release. Those,
I'm sure.
Excised scenes.
Everything's a lie.
Yeah, it's
so
all a lie.
So can't believe the damn thing.
We're all in the
So movie. The gallows hasn't been getting good reviews. We're planning on going to see it as a crew, just to have some popcorn, have an excuse to have some popcorn and beers, and you know, hang out. So we'll leave a review. If we do, we'll talk about it on the show a little bit, or we'll leave it, do a blog thing. But yeah, the gallows. If you've seen it, go ahead, preempt us.
I mean, the story of it is interesting that these guys made a movie and actually put a low-budget version of it up on YouTube, I guess.
I think it was a trailer.
No, more than a trailer. The entire movie.
Was it?
Mm-hmm. Well, not the movie we may see, but a version of it. Not a trailer. It was more...
Well, like the monster. Like monster.
Like monster or something like that. Like a short or something.
Okay.
And this is what I got from the...
Kind of like...
Co-West thing. Yeah, and then some people were like, "Oh, we want to buy this, and you guys should make this." So,
right.
I mean, they actually made some version of it. And this is the better version of it, and
the theatrical version.
Yeah, something like that. Right. I mean, I'm at work the whole time. I listen to these interviews and stuff like that are on coast. So, as I can
absorb. Doesn't your boss listen to this show?
Not this. Yeah, well, yeah. Yeah, I mean, yeah. Well, he should be happy because I'm focusing on his work.
Oh, I see.
And not on what exactly is going on in my ears.
So we'll go see that as a crew and we'll let you know how it is.
Yeah.
So, you guys, speaking of, we're about just out of time, but we have a couple more. You guys just went on a little adventure. You guys do this every
this
once in a while.
This is what I was talking about earlier. Let's bring it
this
around,
is the one
guys.
Adventure I won't, go back. On, but these are I enjoy hearing what you guys
Yeah, I'm working experience. On editing a future episode of the Necronomicast that'll come out after this one does some point. The three of us, Doug, myself, and Zip, and our friend Harlan, went to Atchison, Kansas to visit the infamous Sally House. And so, I'm not going to give away too much, but we did a...
Nothing happened.
Oh! Yep, that's true.
Nobody got scratched.
Not haunted.
No penetration. No nothing.
No.
So, but what we're going to do is we're going to bring you guys snippets from our evening. You won't hear any EVPs because we didn't collect any, but just to kind of
Are we sure,
you...
though? Have we gone through everything?
I haven't gone through
everything.
There
might be some EVPs. I listened to it.
I haven't gone through...
You know, I think there's some EVPs from our investigation at the Farrar Schoolhouse in Maxwell, Iowa. So who's to say? But what we're going to present to you guys in a future show is just kind of the insight of four guys hanging out on a hot, sweaty night.
I had a Febreze. Like you said, Febreze your pillow, and I had a Febreze mine.
It was musty. Oh, but it was an old, century-old house, and we went down the basement. We tried to conjure the dead, and, you know.
Yeah.
They weren't home.
Yeah, they weren't home.
They were...
Lots of dolls.
They were holes of fun.
we were across the street at that gorgeous bed and breakfast.
Yeah, like what
we
said.
And I were joking about the idea of them following you home.
Yeah.
And I'm like, yeah, they were just waiting in Brian's car the whole time that we were.
Yeah, we're out of here, guys.
And we're sitting there just like, these guys will leave tomorrow. We'll just hang out here in the car, get out of this shitty house.
Yeah, because it was totally a rundown old house. And across the street's this beautiful... like Victorian mansion looking thing that was totally immaculate and really pristine. I was
I think it was called the Tuck You In.
Yeah, I was like, what
the hell? It was the Glick Mansion.
Glick Mansion.
Tuck You In, Bed and Breakfast.
So that's coming up on a future episode of the Necronomicast.
Because I'm staying there next time.
Yeah. Probably cheaper.
So that's what's coming up on a future episode of the Necronomicast. A little short teaser, a little short episode that I think you'll just kind of enjoy listening to our exploits. That's not.
Oh, if you got me in there, I'm sure it'll be.
Yeah.
Oh, or not Doug.
What percent was Doug then?
Doug was 8%.
We have a new nickname for me.
8%. What do they call them? Mangaritas? You know, 8% Doug was in full effect.
I had a whole cooler full of them. I didn't get to the whole cooler, though.
It's good for ghost hunting.
You took some home?
Yeah, there were some left after. Yeah.
There were?
Yeah, like two or three. Yeah. I did a pretty good job.
Yeah, we represented.
But yeah.
We represented. So that's coming up. I hope you guys enjoy it.
I remember watching Captain Ron when everything went to shit. We're like, guys, we got some DVDs in this house here. Let's watch a movie. And
we
found Captain Ron, and we would put that on. And I loved Captain Ron. I'm going to buy that.
Great.
That was good. Good. Hey, swab.
I'm not coming over for movie night that night.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I got to wash my hair. And I'm bald.
Yeah.
I thought it was fun.
Also, we got, we're going to be at Crypticon Kansas City. Check it out online.
Run.
Lots of great celebrities are going to be on there. Some of them have been on our show before, so hopefully we can talk with them again. But yes, we will be there, all of us, and we'll have a table, a vendor's table. So then you can come by, and I'm going to make some t-shirts. We'll have some cool merchandise. You can help out the show by purchasing some merchandise and get our cards. We'll have some free buttons or something like that. But we'll be podcasting to you, so if you're there at Crypticon and you've listened to the show, come up and say hi. You might just be on the show.
Yeah.
We'll talk about stuff. We'll interview some people that are in the crowd, and we'll see all the scary stuff. Doug, you should come in costume. Do some horror cosplay.
Should I be Dark Helmet?
Yes. Yeah, at the horror convention. It would be great. As Dark Helmet.
I will come in. You know, that's more fun. I'm gonna get come up with a costume.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah, I'm not sure what it'll be yet.
Yeah, all right. All right, well, that's it for today's show. We are out of time, but it has been a pleasure to talk with you about sharks. The horrifying sharks. Do it, Doug. There you go. Oh, God. All right, well, this has been the Necronomicast. My name is Wayne.
This is Zip.
This is Brian.
And this was Doug.
We'll see you next time.
You've been listening to the Necronomicast, a weekly podcast produced by Wayne Brecky, part of the Free Life Media Network. For show notes and other information, go to necronomicast.com.
I just didn't see a waveform.
Yeah, it's pulled way back. That's
Jesus
pulled
Christ.
Way out.
It's production.
We got a lot of extra stuff to put at the end of the episode this time.
Wayne's going
to
edit the fuck out of this one.